Thank you very much for the introduction. After this great overview about genotyping in dilated cardiomyopathy, I will show you our results from the last 10 years in a large Dutch cohort with index patients with DCM. Dilated cardiomyopathy, we know systolic dysfunction, dilatation, progression towards heart failure, and many times associated with deadly arrhythmias. The criteria from Luisa Mestroni herself are still in use, published in 1999. And we know many causes that can lead towards dilated cardiomyopathy, but in a significant subset we have an idiopathic dilated cardiomyopathy, and when we look in this group, it is familial in up to 35% of cases. And in the majority of those familial cases, we see autosomal dominant inheritance, where the offspring has a 50% risk to inherit the underlying mutation. But when we look at the pedigrees, we have to be aware, because there is highly variable expression, severe expression, but also really mild signs that can fit with the phenotype. And there's age-related penetrance. We have to keep aware of that. If you screen a relative of a dilated cardiomyopathy family at the age of 40, it can still develop later in life. And we even see non-penetrance in pedigrees. And this variability, well, there's probably much complexity, other modifier genes, epigenetical phenomena, environments, that are involved. The large genetic heterogeneity is clear to us. We know more than 40 genes right now that are involved in the development of this disease. And we also know that there is a genetic overlap. So these genes do not specifically lead to dilated cardiomyopathy, but can also be involved in other forms of cardiomyopathy. The literature shows around 20 to 30% of yield for genetic testing in dilated cardiomyopathy. And again, the news is the truncating titin mutations, which have been found in 25% of familial dilated cardiomyopathy. What are the implications? It can facilitate genetic cascade screening. It can be useful for diagnostic clarification. And it is interesting to study the genotype-phenotype correlations, and even sometimes it guides towards the clinical management, as we just saw for LMNA and the decision for an ICD in those individuals. But there are also limitations. Time-consuming, high costs, there's still some unsolved families, and the interpretation can be very difficult. So what is the goal of our study? We give an overview of what we saw the last 10 years in a Dutch cohort of dilated cardiomyopathy. We were looking for founder mutations, and we were looking for potential genotype-phenotype relations. So we collected data from four Dutch university hospitals. The patients, they were admitted in a period between 2000 and 2011 to their cardiogenetic outpatient clinics. And we included idiopathic dilated cardiomyopathy index patients above the age of 16. And the diagnosis was made and verified according to the criteria of Luisa Mestroni. And we excluded patients where there were signs for syndromal or mitochondrial causes. And all these patients were classified in three separate groups. One group with familial dilated cardiomyopathy, one group with sporadic dilated cardiomyopathy, and a group with dilated cardiomyopathy and associated neuromuscular disease. When looking at the data, we specifically noted the conduction disease, atrial tachyarrhythmias, but also endpoints like that, the malignant ventricular arrhythmias, and those are the real resuscitations or appropriate ICD charges, and the heart transplantation. But we also looked at the neurologic effects evaluation in the patients and also in the family history. And of course, we carefully looked at the family history and we advised screening to first-degree relatives. And these data are also very important when we are going to do the genetic interpretation we really need to do and have the co-segregation in the families. Over the years, different genetic screening techniques were used, and only in the LMNA gene we also did MLPA to detect large deletions. And the strategy was to do the consecutive screening of genes, so not the new stuff where you do 50 genes in once, but we really went through all the genes one by one. And when a novel gene came out, we add the gene, and when after screening 150 patients and we did not find a mutation in Delta sarcoglycan D gene, by example, we deleted the gene. And as soon as we found a really underlying mutation, we stopped. So we went over all the variations and mutations that have been identified over the last 10 years very carefully. We looked at all the aspects we heard about today and yesterday. And a great advance is that we now have high numbers of controls that are publicly available in the Exome Variant Server, but also from a Dutch cohort where we have also 1,000 Dutch exomes. And it is very important to have the family data again to look at the co-segregation, because sometimes you really have a variant of unclassified significance which you really think it is pathogenic, but you need the co-segregation to really decide it is pathogenic. And we classified all the variation as either pathogenic or as a variant of unknown clinical significance with three categories, or as a polymorphism. We included 418 patients, 224 with familial dilated cardiomyopathy, 173 with sporadic, and just 22 patients with also associated neuromuscular disease. And in 62% of those patients, there was familial disease. And here's the yield. After the screening of 1 up to 14 genes, we had a yield of 62% of mutations in the group with neuromuscular disease, a yield of 25% in the familial dilated cardiomyopathy, and a yield of 8% in the sporadic dilated cardiomyopathy. And we look at the genes, we see that the PLN and the LMNA and the beta MIH7 are the major players in our cohort. And when we look at, especially at the neuromuscular associated phenotypes, we see different genes. All these analyses in all these 10 years, what was the yield per gene? Well, if we look at the LMNA gene, we screened this gene in the majority of patients. We found 5% of mutations in our cohort. But when we specifically look for AV block in these patients, the yield is 22%. The PLN, I will talk about it a little bit more later on, had a yield of 14%. And then MAH7 with a yield of 2%. The rest was lower, but you can appreciate that specific genes with specific red flags, they can have a really high yield, like the myotonic dystrophy phenotype or Duchenne, which can also be just dilated cardiomyopathy sporadically with increased CK levels. Then about the mutations. All these PLN index patients had the same mutation. The LMNA mutations we identified were 16 different mutations in 19 individuals. And the PLN mutation we published recently, we published the clinical data about that, and I will just give you a few slides on this topic. This founder mutation is associated with an arrhythmic cardiomyopathy, left or right involvement, and frequently associated with low voltage on the EKG. And we very often, when we get the first letter of a patient with a copy of the EKG, we have the diagnosis ready there. Phospholamban is important for calcium homeostasis, and in contrast to titin, this is the smallest gene we have, only one exon, in contrast to 363 exons. So that was really handy to screen for us. We not only screened, this is the data from my colleague, Paul van der Zwaag from Groningen. We not only screened our Dutch patients with dilated cardiomyopathy, but also with ARVC, where we also find in 12% of cases this founder mutation, and even in a USA patient. We showed this is a founder mutation by haplotype analysis, and the mutation is estimated to be between 600 and 800 years old. And when we look at the clinical characteristics, we see there's more ICD shocks, more sudden cardiac death in families. So this is an arrhythmic cardiomyopathy, and you can discuss about the classification because the patients sometimes fit in the criteria of dilated cardiomyopathy and sometimes they fit in the ARVC criteria, but this is of course one genetic cause and one phenotypic spectrum, so this is a phospholombanopathy. And it is interesting to know why some patients develop towards a DCM or some patients develop more in the arrhythmogenic direction. And Angelica Asimaki and her group showed that there was more often a depressed or absent placoglobin signal in ARVC patients compared to dilated cardiomyopathy patients. So this difference in the diagnostic test that they published in 2009 is not a genotype-specific test, but a phenotype-specific test. And why this is this phenotype, probably other genetic factors or epigenetics or environmental factors may play a role. So back to our data of the 418 patients, we found a lot of index patients with the PLN founder mutation, 19 index patients with LMNA mutations, but we also found travel mutations in the MIH7 gene, a founder mutation in the Desmin gene, and some other mutated genes. We only identified two complex genetic status cases, but we did not systematically looked for it because as soon as we identified an underlying mutation, we stopped with screening, so we might have missed some of the complex genetic status cases. And when we look at the clinical data of this cohort, when we compare the patients where we did identify a mutation compared to the group where we did not identify a mutation, we see more often AV block, atrial tachyarrhythmias, neuromuscular involvement, and familial history for dilated cardiomyopathy and neuromuscular involvement. And when we look at gene-specific clinical characteristics, where we only looked at the PLN patients and the LMNA patients, because the other gene carriers were, the numbers were too low, we can see that the characteristics are attributable to the LMNA gene, where we see the AV block and the atrial tachyarrhythmias and the neuromuscular involvement. And we see in PLN carriers, we see more often sudden cardiac death below 45 in the family. We also looked at the endpoints, as I explained. And when we look at the combined endpoint, where we look at death from any cause and heart transplantations and the malignant ventricular arrhythmias, we see that the result is worse, the outcome result is worse for mutation carriers compared to the non-carriers. And when we also look at graphs from the gene-specific characteristics, we see that this seems mainly attributable due to the arrhythmic phenotype of the LMNA and PLN carriers. So what are the strengths and the weaknesses of this study? Well, it is a large, well-defined cohort. We did extensive screening, and we were really careful in classifying all the variants we found. But of course, this is an underestimation of the genetic causes. We didn't include Titan yet. And it also might be an underestimation of complex genetic status because we stopped after finding an underlying mutation. In conclusion, the overall yield in our cohort was 20%, which is similar to other studies. But when we look at the specific subgroups, there's a huge difference with high yield in the DCM combined with neuromuscular disease, 25% detection in familial dilated cardiomyopathy and 8% in sporadic dilated cardiomyopathy. In our cohort, PLN and LMNA were the major players, and we do have Dutch founder mutation. And genotype-phenotype relations, well, it is limited but possible, and especially in our cohort for LMNA and PLN mutation carriers. And what's next? Of course, we all know targeted next generation sequencing. We have already nice results of it from our cohort. We have a panel of 48 genes, and well, that will be the next study. Thank you very much, and I would like to thank my colleagues from the Netherlands.
I'm always intrigued by the frequency of founder's effect that you have and makes very unique also your population. So for instance, in the phospholamban mutation, how much variability of expression do you find?
Yeah, that's a very good question. The first publication that just came out shows it's probably a really malignant cardiomyopathy with a lot of arrhythmic events. But now we see the family cascade screening results and we see an enormous spectrum. I also see patients who got a pacemaker at the age of 84, by example, and never any cardiac complaints. And in contrast, you see sudden cardiac death in a 20-year-old boy. So it's extreme, the phenotypic variants.
Very interesting.
And we are really lucky because now we can collect, and well, we maybe even can collect 1,000 individuals with this gene, and then we can start the modifier effects.